country. One of the reasons we organized this conference was because the way in which the media generally reports Latin America is atrocious, apart from other things which it reports. We're very fortunate today in having on our platform two journalists who are completely fit with that mold and represent, if you like, the voice of progress, at least in the press. I'm very pleased to welcome our next speaker, Owen Jones.
Friends, Latin America was one of the first testing grounds for neoliberalism, and unsurprisingly the site of the most decisive breaks from neoliberalism yet. But it was a continent that for so long suffered from so many murderous attempts to crush the aspirations of its people. The bullets, the stadiums crammed with the soon to be murdered, the torture chambers, the firing squads, the bodies left by the sides of the roads, the helicopters from which political dissidents were thrown. Here are the traumas that continent has suffered as landlords and oligarchs fought demands from below for social justice with despicable regimes armed and backed by Western power. It is a trauma that was impressed on me at a young age. Like other socialists in South Yorkshire, in the 1970s, my parents took in refugees who fled Pinochet's barbaric regime in Chile. It was an act of solidarity I'm proud my family and their friends took part in. One was a woman with her kids, her husband murdered, she'd been raped and tortured. It was an experience from which she never recovered, and she ended her life by throwing herself off a Sheffield tower block. There was a proud tradition in this country of working people expressing their solidarity with the oppressed and subjugated of Latin America, like the Liverpool Dockers and the workers at Rolls-Royce who risked their jobs and their livelihoods by refusing work that aided the Chilean regime. Now we have this wave of Latin American governments that have broken with the Washington consensus. They, of course, have been subjected to a relentless campaign of propaganda. Those orchestrating this campaign are cynical indeed. They are silent or even supportive of continued Western support for some of the most barbaric regimes on the face of the earth. Like the horror show that is the Saudi dictatorship, which murders its citizens for being witches and sorcerers, which deprives women of the most basic rights, a head-chopping, wrist-cutting medieval theocracy armed to the teeth by Western powers, like the dictatorship of Kazakhstan, for which Tony Blair himself works for millions of pounds. The hypocrisy of these so-called human rights crusaders, the shamelessness knows no bounds. But let's talk about human rights abuses in Latin America. Let's talk about those abuses in Venezuela. Let's talk about February 1989, when a president elected on the basis he'd stand up to the IMF, which he called a neutron bomb that left buildings standing, began instituting a neoliberal shock programme, and when his own people tried to resist an onslaught for which he had no mandate, he turned his guns on them. When hundreds were killed as soldiers fired into residential buildings, people would disappear, unarmed civilians killed. This, of course, was Venezuela's Tiananmen Square. These are the sorts of human rights abuses that once took place in Venezuela, studiously ignored by the sorts of people who today cry foul. Now, I've been very lucky to be an election observer in Venezuela, in the election that returned Hugo Chavez to power just before he passed away. I observed an election process that the former US President Jimmy Carter described as the best in the world. 16 elections since Chavez was first elected back in 1999, all of them judged fair and free by international observers. Before he came to power, millions of poor Venezuelans were not even registered to vote. When he lost the constitutional referendum in 2007, he didn't resist or defy the will of the people. He accepted the result. It is his opponents, of course, who have refused to accept democratic norms. They tried to overthrow him in a Pinochet-style coup with tacit and often overt Western support. Only then was he restored to power by the resistance of his own people. Now, in this country, where civil liberties are attacked with the justification of terrorism, I wonder how our own government would have responded to a bloody coup overthrowing them, incited and backed by the likes of ITN and Sky News. Now, the results of this Venezuelan revolution speak for themselves. Extreme poverty having dropped from nearly a quarter down to 9%, poverty overall halved, unemployment halved, GDP per capita doubled, a housing programme that has given hundreds of thousands homes, oil exports surged fourfold and no longer wasted on the elite but used for social programmes to emancipate the people of Venezuela. Perversely, Chavez, of course, was accused of bribing the electorate. In the world of the neoliberals, satisfying the needs and wants of the people amounts to bribery. Now, in the UN last year, found that Venezuela and Ecuador had led the region in reducing poverty. In Ecuador, poverty has gone down by a quarter in just 4 years. Unemployment there is way below our own rate. In Bolivia, poverty reduced by a quarter and extreme poverty by nearly half under Evo Morales. These are social transformations giving people hope, security, dignity, and the future. But all of these governments face threats from within and from without. Vigorous attempts to destabilise them by local elites backed by foreign powers. Now we know US power is in decline, battered by the calamity of the Iraq War, the financial crisis, the rise of powers like China, and the election of these governments in Latin America. But we also know it's empires in decline that lash out most aggressively. That is why international solidarity is so important, to defend the right of national self-determination, to support democratically elected governments finally emancipating and liberating those who toil and struggle, who have been oppressed and subjugated for decades, generations, centuries, to realise the hopes and dreams and aspirations of millions. And then there are the social movements of Colombia, risking their liberty and their lives, like the Patriotic March, which has lost 26 activists this year. As they fight for freedom and emancipation, we must make sure they do not stand alone, that Western governments cannot be allowed to stand by silently as they are oppressed and killed. Now, it's not about importing these revolutions as they are. We live in different countries. The break from free market capitalism will manifest itself in very different ways in different contexts. But the existence of these governments gives us hope because it punctures the tyranny of there is no alternative. And that is our mission. That is our mission. Latin America gives us hope. But our mission is this: to build a new world. To give a hope to all who toil and struggle, whether on the salt plains of Bolivia or the supermarkets of Oldham. Another world is not just possible, another world is necessary. And together, all of us, on whichever continent, we must and we will build it. Solidarity.
See who's on it, and when Owen's on it, I make a particular point of watching it. And what's quite clear is the positive response that audiences give to many of his answers, if not all of them. And I wish some of the politicians that allegedly speak for progressive ideas spoke with the same degree of clarity and forthrightness when they're actually on Question Time or speaking anywhere else. Thank you very much.